Hey everybody, and welcome to the PC Gamer Show. My name is Tom Marks, Associate Editor here at PC Gamer, and your host, as usual, with me today is Mr. Evan Lottie, Editor-in-Chief here at PC Gamer. How you doing, Evan?
Doing well, considering I watched some video of my face getting melted today.
Yeah, that must have been a harrowing experience.
Yeah, I can't talk much more about that, but check PCGamer.com on Monday.
It's going to be an exciting day.
It will be.
We'll be definitely talking about whatever happens on Monday, the following show. Well, also joining us today is Chris Livingston, again via the magic of the interwebs. How you doing, Chris?
I'm doing very good. I haven't had any face melting myself, but I'm otherwise pretty good.
It's been a stable faced Wednesday for you.
Yeah, pretty much an average face day. Nothing unusual.
That's good. It's been a weird face day, I guess, because James came in all shaved, too.
I know. Everything's changing.
There's, like, a joke that every time me and James and like, Bo or someone is on the show, it's always three beards, right? And the beard is gone. I almost brought him on. I almost was like, no, we're changing the schedule. We're bringing James on just so we can see him clean-faced. Panzerg 2 just resubscribed for 4 months, so we're starting the show right today. It's going to be a good day. We're talking about a few different things. We'll be talking about the Skyrim Special Edition, which we briefly talked about. Actually, two games we briefly talked about in a different context last week. Skyrim Special Edition. We'll also be talking about Titanfall 2 and how much we're enjoying that. But before we talk about Titanfall 2, we're going to be looking at an update Valve made to Steam's screenshot policy and how you present your games on their storefront. And then we'll be looking forward to this weekend because me and Will will be going to BlizzCon, which is this Friday, Saturday. So we're going to do some predictions for what we think we might see out of that, kind of rapid fire for each of their games because they have too many to fit into a show now that we just got to get through them. And of course, we'll be taking your questions from Twitch chat at the end of the show, so be sure to stick around for that. Scarfington, the guy behind the camera, also just resubscribed, so thank you, Will. But let's start out, like we always do, with what we've been playing recently. Evan, since I think you've had the longest gap since being on the show, what have you been into lately?
Yeah, I think I've put about 20 or 30 hours into Civ since release. So plenty of that. Let's see, I did most recently, I did a cultural victory for America, which is Teddy Roosevelt. That was very fun, except, so I don't know, I should back up a little bit. I think Civ 6 is excellent. I'm immediately enjoying it. I'm delighted by this digital board game. I mean, that's what Firaxis does best. But I have just tons of little annoyances that, things that frustrate me about the biggest systems of the game and how poorly they're explained, I think, is like the general theme. So I think tooltips in general, these are some of the worst tooltips or they don't explain stuff that's like really important. So, you know, Civ 6, big focus on city building and like planning of your tiles and your cities because they sprawl outward over time in a much different way. And adjacency bonuses are like a big point of that. So you have these things called districts, or like a category of tiles that you build. Like you have an entertainment district or the money making district. I forget what it's called. And
I think that's commercial.
Commercial. Thanks, yeah. Tom.
The commercial district, thanks. Evan?
And you build neighborhoods, which are like a housing district. You can build multiple of those. And you have to think really deliberately about like, okay, well, there's this luxury resource there. I want to protect that, but like I also want, I'm going for tourism, so I want my entertainment district in the middle, my theater district in the middle, so I want to surround that with other districts, but I get bonuses from a mountain, and like, you know, it's a puzzle. It's a really fun, satisfying part of the game to do over time as you're dealing with the other civilizations around you. The game doesn't visually represent those bonuses. It only does so when you're building, not throughout the game. So like a huge fundamental part of like how you win, how you achieve victory is just not surfaced for you to figure out in Civ 6. Religion is a big new system. There's a religious victory. That wasn't in Civ 5. Awesome. It's poorly explained. I had this weird system situation where so the way like religion works is like you send missionaries and apostles and inquisitors to basically conquer enemy towns. So they're waging like this parallel form of war where these religious units can't fight with military units, but military units can like cancel them out if they step on them.
If you're at war, yeah.
If you're at war, yeah. again, something that isn't explained. So I noticed that, like, you know, I found a religion. I was playing a Saladin, and I found a religion called Evangelism. So I was sending out, I was like, oh man, I don't know, some other civilization had, like, taken over, like, greater than 50% control of one of my main cities. I was like, oh, I have to take that back. So I go to that city and I build a religious unit, and I, you know, I build an apostle and I hit the button to, like, spend its power, basically. Like, you consume the unit as you use it, kind of like a traitor. And the city loses all of my religion, and my opponent's religion has complete control. And I'm like, but I just use that unit. And it turns out that when you build a religious unit in one of your cities, it builds for whatever religion is most dominant in that city. So I built an opponent's unit and use it on my city to extinguish my own religion. Why would I ever want to do that? There was no warning, no explanation, no, like, disclaimer that was going to happen, you know? Religion has
God works in mysterious ways.
There you go. I mean, religion in itself is kind of unsatisfying right now. We just published an article yesterday, three things that we think civilization's expansions have to fix or have to address. We definitely think that system should get some love. Tourism, by the same way, is kind of just like a big number that you look at that grows over time. It doesn't really explain, like, how tourists are attracted between cities. Anyway, Civ 6 is wonderful regardless of that stuff. I love collecting great works. I think that's a really satisfying part of the game. You know, you're seeing, like, you're going on archaeological digs and you're getting these artifacts and you're getting, like, you know, Chopin or Beethoven or Mary Shelley or all these, like, great people, and they're producing stuff and they exist in a specific spot in your world. In this, like, you know, you build a film studio and it has Beethoven's symphony or whatever. And it's just cool to see, like, all that stuff that your culture has collected, all these little artifacts, you know, represented on screen. That's a really cool aspect of it. Other than Civ 6, I got back into the Overwatch Halloween stuff at the tail end just to see if I could get some more Halloween loot crates.
Get those sweet skins.
I ended up spending 3,000 credits on the Dr. Junkenstein skin because I really like, I do like Junkrat. He's, like, my third most played. Yes, that was good. And I'm just starting up Titanfall 2, which we'll be talking about later.
Yeah. Real.
Hey, was it you, Evan, in your Civ game that someone stole the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel?
Oh, yeah. I think I shared an image of that I saw on social media. So you can spies, you know, you can send them to steal cultural works, I think, like great works. I think that's how it works. They have a number of different actions. I haven't done that myself. But yeah, the Sistine Chapel is one of the things that you can build. Yet, you know, Michelangelo is a great person, and that exists somewhere, and you can just take it. If you have a percentage of success, of course. But yeah, just imagine that happening, right? It's however many, like, dozens of
meters. It's a hell of a height.
Meters wide.
Considering stealing a gigantic ceiling, first of all.
Yeah.
Plus, I mean, one that is famous for people constantly looking up at it. I mean, you got to be a real gifted thief for that kind
you
of.
You got gravity working against you. I think only Locke Lamora, if anybody's read that book, can pull off that kind of heist.
MotherGoose604 just subscribed, so thank you very much. But yeah, I echo a lot of your things. It's this weird thing with Civ 6 for me where, like you were saying, it is just, I think it's one of the best Civ games they've ever made, especially out of the box. And it does a surprising amount of things really annoyingly. Like, just kind of doesn't explain them or doesn't explain them enough or are a little bit baffling that they would make such a decision. And I don't know.
I had another situation where I just couldn't figure out if something was a bug or a system that I wasn't understanding. So I occupied a city and I was penalized for 100 turns for a long period of time where the city wasn't growing. Like, it wasn't adding any new citizens. And it said, like, occupied city, you're penalized. And I was like, well, how do I make this go away? There's no explanation. I went into Civopedia, like the, you know, all the searchable reference area for Civ instruction manual thing. And there's like one sentence dedicated to occupying a city. That's like such a fundamental aspect of what you do in this game. It's literally a way to achieve victory. And the section for it is just, you know, flavor text, basically. It doesn't explain what happens or how you manage the consequences of that. So I don't know. Maybe it was a bug, but I can't figure it out.
There's some quality of life things that need to be updated with that game, before they do an expansion. And I think that's part of it. Like the Civilopedia needs like a little bit more context in some spots.
I hope we get some good questions about Civ. I hope some other folks are playing it and have some thoughts to share about the AI. I mean, a lot of people are talking about that right now. But
well, Chris, what have you been jumped on anything new since last time we spoke?
Something not quite so new, but I don't think I talked about it on the show, was Miscreated, which is an early access survival sandbox. It's pretty much impossible to talk about it without talking about DayZ, since it is does have a lot of similarities. It's very much you know, you start off with basically nothing. You're in a big map with other players around, and you have to kind of gear up and eat and drink and, you know, gather gear and clothing and weapons and kind of explore. And there are not zombies, but mutants running around. So it does have a lot of similarities with DayZ. And something I looked at last year when it first went into early access, I think in April 2015, and I only just recently started playing it again, just immediately kind of got really into it. And I'm sorry if you can hear that. That is a leaf blower outside.
I was gonna say, outside my window. It sounds like you are currently in the post-apocalypse, and like that's an air raid siren or something. Something is coming for you, Chris. Run!
Until he leaves. Okay. We'll get back to you. Why don't you go, Tom?
Yeah, we'll go. We'll come back to you. I've been jumping between Civ a lot, Titanfall 2 a good amount. I think that I drifted away from Battlefield 1, actually. I had been playing that an okay amount, and kind of just, I don't know, it didn't hold me as much as some other shooters.
Me too, weirdly.
Which is surprising, because it wasn't any sort of personal preference against it, or like, I thought it was a great game. Everything I've said praising it, I stand by. It's just, it didn't get its hooks in me as much as some other games recently. I've still been playing lots and lots of Duelist. That's the type of game where I literally sign on every day to do the daily challenge, even if I don't actually play the games, because they have these little kind of lethal puzzles, and I'm like, I'm playing that all the time. I'm pretty much a broken record in terms of the games I've been playing lately. I've been stuck on a couple for a little bit, and of course, Titanfall we're going to get to later in the show, so I can save that. I'm nervous. Chris, we need to come up with like a hand signal or something. You need to just like flag us down when the leaf blower is gone. But until then, let's. I'm sorry, it's just so good. I like that you're there in like the frozen presence of the monitor, but then also can't say anything. It's just kind of like you're chilling in the side seat of the show right now, which we're glad to have you this way. Well, we're glad to have you in general.
Yeah, he keeps going away and teasing me, and then he comes on back, so.
Okay.
I'll give a double thumbs up when he's gone or okay. Someone has murdered.
We'll be on the lookout.
It is fall.
Yeah, I guess it is. That's actually a game that I wanted to bring up last week that I tried to get back into, and I haven't had a chance yet, is Stardew Valley. I still haven't really played Stardew Valley since its 1.1 update, or at least not as much as I want to, and I'm not sure why that is. Like, it's the type of game where I love it, but it sounds so... It's one of the games that just feels so daunting to, like, pick back up after a long time, because I don't want to restart a game, you know, a couple years into a farm, because then it took, you know, dozens of hours to get to that point. But I also don't want to just, like, jump into this farm that I have no idea what I'm doing or, like, who I'm in love with and all that sort of stuff, what buildings I was building.
Who am I?
I don't know. It's just Stardew Valley was a very it started it, and I was very, you know, like, this is not my beautiful house. This is not my beautiful wife sort of, like, what's going on? Where am I in the world?
I think you just want to wait until you can experience all the new stuff at once. And you know that co-op is coming. You know that other stuff is coming. So, like me, I haven't touched the latest update. I'm going to wait.
So you're waiting for the co-op, though?
Oh, yeah.
God, that's going to make that game so different.
Yeah.
I'm really curious how to do it.
I did a year and a half, and, like, I kind of know what's going on. I mean, the game runs out of content after about 45 hours, Tom. like completely.
That's a kind of hilarious thing to say, though, right? Only 45 hours, and then there's nothing.
No, I mean, I played for 60, you know, and, you know, the game technically just continues on and on and on for years, but...
Actually, I saw a video just the other day of a guy who made a farm. He had, like, a video of a crop that he harvested in year 38 of that game. But he was using something. It was either a mod or the new gold clock that you can get in the game lets you skip time. So he was doing it where he just wanted to build or farm as many of this one type of berry as he could. And so he planted it in fall, skipped to the end of fall, harvested everything, put all those seeds in the berries in the seed maker, skipped to the next fall, then like did it again and like doubled his seeds three times in a row, and then sold everything all at once in the year 38, and it was like 13 million gold in a single harvest. So
I mean, cool. You can't buy anything with that money.
I know, right?
But like, he's a time traveling farmer. Congratulations.
Well, his thing was that he had to spend $10 million on the gold clock. So it was.
Oh.
Yeah, it was to pay that back, except a little excessively, I think. But let's move on to our first topic. Whether Chris is voiceful or not, voiceful. I'm not sure what the right word there would be. Anyway, Skyrim Special Edition just came out last week, and Chris has been the one playing it mostly. So we'll try to dance around the fact that he can't really talk without killing everyone's ears. But,
I think we're good at the moment.
Oh, we're good?
Well, for the moment, he keeps circling back.
Okay, quick, tell us everything you know about Skyrim Special Edition. Are you liking it? Have you been playing it? What's the deal?
I've played it a bit. I mean, not really sitting there to play it as an adventure RPG, but to sort of check it out, see how it works, see if I could use any of my old original Skyrim saves with the new version, which they were telling us probably not. You probably can't do that if you have a modded save. You can't bring it over, and that does appear to be true. I mean, I had a save that had a single mod on it, and I disabled it and resaved it and brought it over, and it the game opened it, but there was problems. Like, you couldn't use first-person mode. It kept popping out into third-person, and you can't do it. You can bring over your unmodded saves, but not your anything that you use the mod with.
Yeah, so we didn't review the special edition, of course, because it's just a visual upgrade. But you were saying this morning, Chris, that you felt like Bethesda could have done much more with this.
Well, I feel like this is the same game that was basically shipped. And the game that shipped, like Bethesda's RPGs in general, they have tons of bugs and glitches and problems and goofy things. And we all kind of know that. Like, there's always just stuff going wrong.
It's kind of a charming thing at a certain point, almost.
Depends on who you ask.
It depends. I suppose. Yeah. Depends on who you ask, and it depends on, like, you know, Fallout 3 for me, like, that game crashed like crazy. And, like, that was not a fun, curious little glitch. That was a giant pain in the ass for me. So, yeah, and you see that, you know, they have their mod store, and they've got modders bringing over their stuff. And of course, the number one mod is by Arthmore, this guy who basically fixed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of bugs and glitches and problems and those goofy little things. He's fixed them all. And you can mod the new Skyrim edition with this mod, but it's kind of, I don't know, at this point I just felt like when I started playing the special edition for the first time and I started a new game and you're on the wagon with the horse and you go down and the guy gets beheaded, et cetera, et cetera. First thing that happened is I get off the wagon and we walk over to the little execution pit and there's this horse just standing in the middle of this scene, this dramatic scene where you're being brought to execution, and the I don't know who it was, the chief executioner is walking into the horse. The horse is being pushed. The horse is looking around like he doesn't know what's going on. There's another actor trying to get around. And then so they execute the guy, and then the horse is still right there. And there's something supposed to happen, and it's not happening because the fucking horse is in the way. And I had to stop. I mean, I had to restart. I was sitting there for 5 minutes. Everyone in the scene, all the NPCs, everyone's just staring. And it just brought to mind, like,
Chris, that horse saved your life.
Yeah, exactly. He did. he doomed me to a life of standing around staring at him. But it's just, you know, I understand the reason they didn't tinker with the guts of the special edition, because that would mean you couldn't just bring a mod over that existed. They would have to redo pretty much every mod. It would be like an official patch. Every time an official patch rolls out, it screws up mods and modders have to fix it. So I get that sort of idea, like, we want this to be as easy as possible. But on the other hand, you know, it nicely coincides with them not having to fix their busted-ass game. And in the interim, in these years that have gone by, I really feel like that either they should have patched Skyrim a lot more, or they should have approached these modders who have fixed all of these hundreds and hundreds of problems and said, hey, we want to incorporate your mod as an official patch. You did all this work. Here's some money. You know, we're Bethesda. We wanted to get modders paid with this Steam paid mods thing. This is a great opportunity to pay some modders. They spend hours and hours of their free time. You know, I'm sure they didn't ask for money. They do it because they love the game. But what a great opportunity. Hey, Arthmore, you have a collection of hundreds of bug fixes. We're going to make it an official patch to the game. Here's some money. Or you're hired, maybe, you know, just as an option. So, yeah, like, I do understand why they didn't really tinker with the guts of it. At the same time, it's sort of, you know, it's sort of weird to issue a remaster and immediately, you know, you see videos of horse carts flopping around and my thing with the horse. And I don't know. It's kind of a, you know, kind of aggravating, even though I understand the reasons for it.
Well, there's bugs in that engine that they didn't even fix for Fallout 4. Right? Like, there were bugs that were in the original Skyrim that when they released Fallout 4, people were like, oh, the NPCs still do this dumb thing that they did in Skyrim. Like, so it doesn't really surprise me that they either weren't willing or just decided not to fix those things for this remaster. The thing that bums me out, though, is what you were saying about how, like, they didn't even touch the UI. Like, just seems, like, crazy to me that they wouldn't do more, especially when they know, because they know that modders have done amazing things to make the original Skyrim way better. So if I was Bethesda, I would have taken that as a challenge to be like, you know what, we got to step up. We got to really make this special edition worth it. And they just didn't do that.
I mean, you compare it to what Firaxis did with XCOM 2, right? They saw the success of the Long War in XCOM. I mean, that was where the hardcore XCOM players went. That's where a lot of the YouTubers and folks went. That's what they played. That was a hardcore marathon version of the game. And they hired modders to make official mods that went live, like, on day zero, as an expression of, like, hey, XCOM's super moddable. Here's some stuff right out the gate. And also as a way of thanking and incorporating that work, you know? That
yeah.
Team. So it's a missed opportunity because, like you said, Skyrim is one of the most modded games ever, and it will be. I mean, it's probably below Half-Life 2 and stuff, but
and they did, you know, they did give some modders early access to the beta of the special edition so they could get their mods over there, and Arthmore was one of them. And frankly, I probably shouldn't speak out of turn. I don't know that they didn't pay him for the time he spent working on the early access or on the special edition to get his mods over there for launch. I don't really know, but it just feels like to me, yeah, it's a missed opportunity. There's a huge community of really talented, devoted people, and it seems like, you know, treat it like a talent pool. And we've seen modders, like you said, hired by studios because they make games better, and it seems like this would have been a good opportunity at some point in the past 5 years to bring on some of these folks.
So here's a question that GinaFix just asked in the chat, or asked somewhat in the chat, and that I'm curious about as well, which is, so is it, as of now, I guess, like, is the special edition better than vanilla Skyrim? And then additionally, like, do you think it, like, what do you see as the future of this game? Because the future of Skyrim was mods for a long time, and you can't, it's kind of unfair to judge, like, fully modded for 5 years Skyrim to Skyrim Special Edition where it just came out and the mods aren't even really in yet.
Yeah, it's going to be, I mean, the story of this special edition is going to come in the future when modders start putting together new mods, taking advantage. There's more memory they have now. It was I think it was 2 gigs or something. There was a hard limit on how much memory your mod could use, and now that's changed. It's expanded. So I think it's going to be, you know, probably a few years down the line when we see if this was really worth it. Right now, it's hard to say. I mean, I think if you're buying, I don't know, if you were buying Skyrim for the first time, I don't know. I honestly don't know. I might even say stick with the original version just because there are so many mods for it. And a lot of those mods are going to come over to the special edition, but there are some mods that modders created, and they're not going to go and update it. They're not going to move it over. They're not going to make a version for special edition. So you might be missing out on some stuff that's existing that you might enjoy. On the other hand, if you're maybe only going to use a few mods, or you're just checking out the game for the first time, you know, I have to say that the special edition does look nicer. It took me a while to see it. When I got it, I kind of was walking around in there. I was like, I don't get, why is this so good? And I kind of looked at the old one and thought, well, this doesn't look much different. But when I actually compared the screenshots side by side, I said, oh, yeah, wow, the colors are much richer and the lighting is nicer and there's more depth, it feels like, when you're standing out in the wild. It is an improvement. The water effects look nicer, definitely. But again, there are mods for the original that can do that kind of thing as well. So, well, I don't know. I'm not sure which I'd recommend, to be honest.
Not to be, you know, reductionist or anything, but, like, is the Skyrim Special Edition just for consoles? Like, is that why they made it? Is it kind of an irrelevant thing to PC gamers in a weird way? I mean, obviously, the modding capacity is very, very cool, but at least in its initial launch.
I mean, it definitely was, I would say, focused on consoles to, you know, for the new consoles, and there's mods available like they did with Fallout. They've started their Bethesda modding site, and you can get those mods on console now. It does feel, even the DLC, some of the DLC for Fallout 4 felt like it was for consoles, not really for PC gamers, because it just wasn't that elaborate. I would say, I don't know. It feels like more of a console focus to me.
Cool. Well, Evan, any thoughts on that? I mean, it seems like a very, it's a weirdly polarizing special edition launch in my eyes, because, like, a lot of people are getting very defensive about it or very offended by it in a lot of cases. But then on the flip side of that is they are giving it away for free if you want all the DLC, and it is just an improvement on the game in a certain sense. And I don't know. I was surprised by how much of a hot topic its release has been.
Who's offended?
Okay, maybe I'm projecting.
Okay, I'm just making sure I didn't miss something.
I think some of the problem is people are complaining about this new edition, like, oh, it doesn't do much. But the defense is, well, it's free if you have all Skyrim already. So what are you complaining about? It's this free thing. That's the argument I've seen going back and forth, saying, well, what if I don't have the DLC? Then it's not free. And I, you know, I don't know. That seems to be one of the points of contention, I think.
Yeah. I guess, like, the kind of devil's advocate but counterpoint comment I would make is, okay, CSGO was intended as a console release of Counter-Strike. That is what Valve demoed it on in, like, 2010 or 11. When they were at PAX, it was only on console. And there was going to be cross-platform play between console and PC. That is what CSGO was intended for, because, you know, that generation of consoles was ending. Valve wanted to get their most recent FPS on the console. And what has CSGO evolved into? It has evolved into the biggest competitive shooter of our generation. Overwatch might overtake it, but it will take it, I think, at least a year and a half to do so. So we know what can happen when a game is on PC, naturally, but, you know, I think that the key thing is that extra room for modders to play with. You know, they have a 64-bit executable. You know, I'll let the modders speak to exactly what that means for them and what the difference is in terms of what that's going to allow them to do, but I think that's my hope for the future of the game, and that's the positive thing I take away from it, that, like, if it means we get a couple just groundbreaking standalone mods for special edition, awesome. Like, we won, you know? Big deal that it's still buggy. Like, okay.
Plus, now we can all play it on the Nintendo Switch.
Well, that's not confirmed yet.
I know.
It was just in the trailer.
But I just thought that was the weirdest thing, that this is very not PC, but that their announcement trailer was like showing off a game from 5 years ago. Even if it was the special edition of that game, I think everyone was like, wait, what? Like, that seems like a weird choice.
Nintendo makes...
I'm looking forward to playing it at a rooftop party with all my young, attractive friends. Like, come on over, bring Skyrim.
I mean, we've all got that one fashionable couch in the Nintendo commercials, right? No, Nintendo makes so much hardware. Like, I can't even keep up with it. I say that as somebody who switches graphics cards pretty quickly, but, like, you know, I don't think I've spent, like, maybe an hour with a Wii U, you know? Anyway. Getting off topic.
Getting a little bit off topic. So let's bring it back around. Let's move to our next topic about Steam, a very PC-y thing, and specifically an update that they just made to their screenshot policy for the store. Essentially, the short and long of it is that game developers are no longer allowed to use pre-rendered images like concept art or stills from cinematics or anything like that. To advertise their game within the Steam storefront, they have to use in-game screenshots, basically. They have to use what Valve says are images that better represent what the game you're actually going to be playing is when you buy it. An interesting thing that Wes pointed out was that that does not necessarily outlaw things like the fun term bull shots, of like, we took this image at this in-game screenshot, quote-unquote, at 8K, downsampled it, and then touched it up in Photoshop.
Yeah,
that's still technically an in-game screenshot.
See many Ubisoft games over the past 5 years.
Yeah, we actually have a great article on the site kind of pulling through some of the worst bullshots in PC gaming, in recent PC gaming times. And so it's interesting that they're trying to regulate this a little bit more. They're trying to be a little bit stricter about it. How do you guys feel about that?
Yeah, and you should probably read off like what the exact... It's a pretty long post, but like you should, as we get into this, kind of read off specifically what it is. Yeah, I mean, it's a good thing. If we're talking about marketing and how and what some companies are allowed to get away with or what they do kind of use as their assets and materials. I mean, we called it out explicitly in that article, but obviously like No Man's Sky comes to mind as... a big recent case of, oh man, look at all these spectacular, unique animals and like highly populated environments in the trailer, and no one has found that stuff in game, and it's just, it's not there, you know, and no one's, so yeah, just that discrepancy between trailers and the experience you get when you buy it. And, you know, I think we need to like accept that sometimes a developer has a proof of concept and, you know, things change during development, and we should embrace and accept that. That's the nature of game development. But in terms of what's on your actual store page, you know, that's a retail listing. Yeah, I mean.
So does this
new policy cover trailers, or are they just talking about screenshots?
I believe it's screenshots specifically. The exact wording is, we ask that any images you upload to the screenshot section of your store page should be screenshots that show your game, which, taken out of context, is a pretty straightforward sentence. But they say this means avoiding using concept art, pre-rendered cinematic stills, or images that contain awards, marketing copy, or written product descriptions. Please show customers what your game is actually like to play. And then they actually kind of modest or humbly say, you know, we were violating this and we did it badly on our Dota 2 page, and they removed all of the concept art from their Dota 2 page and replaced it with more modern screenshots. I think it's a little bit weird. I mean, like, I don't really have a problem with seeing a couple concept art images in that section, as long as it's not the only thing. And I guess the weird thing to me is, like, how is Valve planning on enforcing this?
Sure.
Because they have a very, very hands-off approach to the store. They've always had a hands-off approach to the store. That's just kind of their shtick.
The answer is they won't enforce it unless there's egregious examples that the public identifies. I mean, Valve is not going to have people run around poking at Steam pages. I mean, to be clear, Valve does have folks review. I know, you know, it's stated in their early access policy that they have someone internally review early access, you know, the store page before that goes live. You know, they need to sort of manually say, okay, it's good to go. So there's that layer of approval. But yeah, I mean, I think they're mainly setting themselves up for, like, if there is an instance where a screenshot doesn't match what's in game, they're able to say, oh, this person violated the policy.
Yeah, and the other part of this to me is, how much of this is setting up for this big UI redesign that Steam is getting soon? Because we've heard rumblings for a while now, and they've come out and said, we're going to be doing some big changes to the storefront somehow. We have no idea what or how that's going to look or when that's coming, really. But part of me thinks that they're going to be using screenshots differently in the way that they present the games on the storefront page, and they want to make sure it looks like the actual game.
Well, I think it should be coming before the end of this year. I think it's in December. I think it's mentioned in that post. But yeah, I don't know. I just feel like they have bigger fish to fry. Perhaps the UI update will address some of those much larger issues on Steam, but stuff like reviews, I don't know. I think the concept of user reviews is good. And they're helpful, but they're becoming such a overweighted aspect of that game's listing page. And just the fact that, like, so many reviews are jokes, you know, and, like, yeah, you can flag them as funny or say that they're not useful, but, like, I don't know. It's frustrating how many of those reviews. I think Mafia 3 was a good example where, as much as Mafia 3 had issues that a lot of people identified were unhappy with and were right to do so, you know, before the game came out, before it was, like, officially available everywhere, you had folks diving into that Steam page and just giving their criticism as quickly as they could. And they had, like, 0.2 hours played, 0.3 hours played, just to sort of, like, be the first commenter. You know, it's like that kind of mindset that's getting people in there. And that seriously affects how visible a game is on Steam, how people react to it. I'm not saying, like, people don't have a right to voice their opinions, but it feels weirdly heavy within Steam, just the power that an individual angry person who basically has barely played your game can have.
And it really does affect things, too, now that people are using that percentage of positive reviews kind of as almost like a we got this score on Metacritic sort of thing.
I think now when you Google a game, like, just type in, I don't know, like, Evolve Steam or something, like, it shows up as a percentage in Google. As if it's the score.
Evolve is a little bit of a morbid choice,
it says rating 6 out of 10. You know,
yeah.
God, what does that mean? Because it's not as if Steam reviewers are scoring. They're saying thumbs up or thumbs down, right? So does that? I guess that means 60% are positive. You know, that's such a different thing than rating something 6 out of 10. That's so different. So I don't know. I guess. It's part of what we do and part of our background. Hey, Dota 2 is a 9 out of 10. Congrats.
Another issue with those reviews that people write after playing for, you know, 0.6 hours or something is if they then go on to play for 30 hours and don't update their review, other people will come and look at this review that was written at 0.3 hours and say, oh, look, this guy's played 30 hours. And look at this review. He liked it or didn't like it or whatever. Meanwhile, the review was written when he played for, you know, 20 minutes, but it hasn't changed. He never came back to revise it. It just shows now his hours played, his actual hours played. And that can be, you know, definitely misleading. So there's that kind of problem as well.
For sure. It's just sort of become a hotbed for memes. And, you know, I love a good meme about a video game, Chris, Tom, I'm sure you do too. But, like, the 11 out of 10, so on and so forth, or the guy who says, yeah, it's all right, and he's played for, like, 500 hours, like, okay, dude, you know, that was funny the fourth time I saw that, like, several years ago, but you're just taking up space now, you know, congrats. I don't know, as writers, of course, we value people contributing good, constructive things to say, whether they're positive or negative. So I guess I'm particularly harsh on this aspect of Steam, but it's a hugely important one to developers. I can't imagine they're not feeling like, please, Valve, like, change this in a way to make it meaningful. Not to, you know, I don't think they want to dodge criticism even necessarily, but just, like, it has such a huge impact on day one especially.
And it's something I'm both reviews and the screenshot changes is something I feel is like directly affecting me in the way I find games, because I'm looking through Steam every single week. I look at every new game. I try to look at every new game that comes out on Steam for this weekly post we do every Sunday. And the two main things I use to at a glance see if a game is worth looking at further are its first four screenshots, basically, like the stuff that comes up when you're first looking at it, and the initial reviews from users. Like, those are literally the two most important ways I can get a quick sense of a game. Mm-hmm. And if they are changing certain things with that, it's going to have an effect on a lot of different people. It's going to have an effect directly on me and how I find games. Because honestly, like, if I see a piece of nice concept art, like, sometimes that sells me. And sometimes games don't look very good in screenshots. There are a lot of games, for example, Dota 2, where if you showed me a page of eight of Dota 2 screenshots, I probably wouldn't give a crap about that game. But if you showed me really high-quality concept art and then some screenshots, I'd probably give more weight to those screenshots because I say, oh, there's some production behind this, right? They have a clear artistic direction, whereas the screenshots are just kind of static images and don't really tell me much.
Yeah.
I guess, and you've got to figure for spreadsheet-type games, you know, like Out of the Park baseball or anything, any kind of management thing.
It's going to look awful.
I think probably people who like spreadsheet games are like, this is awesome. Look at the spreadsheet. But I think in terms of like drawing someone
look at those
in,
rows. Oh, my
you
God.
You might want to have something cooked up, some sort of nice, you know, eye-catching thing. I can definitely understand having that. As long as it's clear, you know, what is the game and what isn't, I guess that's the thing. It's like, we don't know what's the game and what isn't. We saw with No Man's Sky, looking at some of those trailers and screenshots, it's very easy to, you know, you can understand some of the disappointment, I would say.
Actually, that's an interesting part that got brought up in the comment or the chat, but we didn't touch on. Do you guys think this is a reaction to No Man's Sky? Because that was what some people are quickly kind of saying is like, and I don't personally think that would ever be the sole reason they'd do this. But do you think that had something to do with it?
I feel like there was maybe a renewed focus on this type of stuff because it does come up now and then when we see something at E3 or we see some early trailers and then the game comes out and then, whoa, this doesn't look like that. It comes up, you know, I would say regularly, but it feels like No Man's Sky was a big, like, it was just everyone was kind of talking about it all at once. I think it could be a reaction to that.
I think it begins all the way back with the War Z and games like that. You know, Valve is just, I don't think it's a very important step. I don't think it's a big step, but let's applaud them for doing something responsible, I think, to protect consumers, you know, protect players, help them make decisions that are based in reality. I think that's great.
Cool. Well, let's jump along then to Titanfall 2, which is a game I'm very excited to talk about. We all just started playing it like yesterday because we got code kind of late. But I was so obsessed with the single player that I've played most of it. I think I'm probably about half to two thirds of the way through the campaign already because it was just like so much fun. Chris did our full review, not Chris Livingston, but Chris Thurston over in the UK did our full review for the site, which you can find if you go to pcgamer.com/titanfall-2-review. And you can read his full thoughts there. But man, I like this game. Boy, do I like this game.
So like, I've only put in about 45 minutes. And, you know, I read Chris's review. I was very surprised because I played the first Titanfall as well. And I enjoyed it. But I wasn't like, oh, he's comparing it to Half-Life 2. And he's comparing it to Thief 3. And like all these other he's saying it's as good as Wolfenstein, you know, that single player campaign and stuff like that. So like, okay, wow. That's as good as it gets. So I'm about 45 minutes in, you know, the wall running's cool. The weapons are fine. The setting is interesting. I'm liking talking to my, Titan BT, my robot, but like without spoiling anything, Tom, like what do I have to look forward to other than that? I mean, it's right now it's a little bit fun, but generic so far.
Yeah, so there's... I'm going to try my best not to spoil anything. And that's a little bit tricky to talk about, but if you've read any reviews or if you've seen anything about the game, you've probably seen mention of a specific chapter in the campaign called Effect and Cause, I believe is the name. That is just completely surprising and completely awesome and amazing and absolutely nothing like you would expect from any AAA shooter campaign ever. It introduces a mechanic into the game that is not just shooty guns, basically, and it's a little bit puzzly, and it's awesome. It absolutely deserves to be compared to Half-Life 2. Maybe not the whole campaign, because, you know, running around the jungle collecting power cores is, like, pretty standard shooter fare.
Yeah.
But the level immediately preceding that, and that level are just so much fun. They're so good at, speaking cryptically, they're so good at making you feel powerful and making you feel really, really cool and, like, good at what you're doing, even if you're, like, not, I guess. And it does it in so many subtle little ways. Like, obviously, it gives you this ability that is very strong, but on top of that, you'll walk by these audio logs, and you can play these audio logs of somebody being like, I can't believe one guy took out, like, two groups of soldiers by those elevators. Like, that's incredible. How did one guy do this? And, like, they're talking about you just being awesome, basically. And then you go into these situations, and you are, like, awesome. And it just makes you feel great while you're playing it. And, I mean, like, I played that level, and I was like, they should just make a whole game out of this level. And it to be fair, is not, like, the most original concept for puzzles and levels. It's been done in a few other games.
It's basically Minesweeper, don't lie.
Not quite. No. But it's actually... I won't make that comparison, because if I make this one comparison, there is a game that is completely not a shooter in any way, shape, or form that is very, very similar to what this level's mechanic is. But I never would have thought anybody would ever use that mechanic in a AAA shooting game.
Like, so Mario Kart then?
Yes, basically. you got it. The Titan actually gets wheels.
Great.
And he, like, goes down, and it's just a whole racing level. Chris, you seemed pretty excited about it too.
Yeah, I haven't gotten too far. I think maybe, I don't know, an hour and a half or so, maybe a little further than Evan. And it was immediately a lot of fun. The movement feels great. It's a great looking game. I feel like the progression of the challenge grows pretty well. The weapons are fun. The Titan is fun. I did kind of find myself toward the end of my session kind of like, all right, I've shot, you know, 400 soldiers dead already. And here I am. There's a few more. And, you know, the AI doesn't seem that great. I feel like fighting the enemy Titans hasn't been super fun. Like, I enjoy the weapons and the explosions and all that, but they seem kind of dumb. So I'm hoping, yeah, I feel like when I quit, I was like, okay, I'm ready for whatever the next thing is that I do, however this evolves and changes or gives me a new loadout or something. I'm just kind of like, I reached the point where I was like, yeah, I get it. I'm shooting everyone. I'm killing everyone. What else you got? I am definitely enjoying it. And then the single player campaign.
Do you guys like Doom more than Titanfall 2 as a campaign?
I don't know. That's tricky. I like...
Because they're both fast and, yeah, like, athletic, acrobatic, Twitch FPSs.
I like Doom a lot. I like the feel and the mechanics of Titanfall more. Mm-hmm. But maybe Titanfall gets bogged down a little bit too much in the, like, tell me a story aspect of it, whereas Doom's campaign was so great because it kind of knew exactly what it was and it didn't apologize and it was just like, go kill demons, whatever, have fun. And Titanfall... while it doesn't get in your way with story, like, tries a little harder in that regard. But the actual run and gun, jumpy, shooty mechanics, I think, are great. The guns, yeah, and similar to what Chris was saying, the actual, the Titans themselves seem, like, really cool, but yeah, a little bit disappointing in the combat. I like the foot combat more. Mm-hmm. And especially the boss fights. Like, not to, again, not to give much away, but there are occasionally these, like, basically boss titans that you fight, these special titans with special abilities. But they didn't, I fought two of them so far, and neither of them really felt like I was fighting them any differently than I was fighting other titans. It just felt like, shoot the dude, put up your shield when you can, dodge a little bit, shoot the dude. And that was, you know, it was fun. It just wasn't very, like, it wasn't a very dynamic boss fight. Like, that one level I was talking about was more interesting than any fight I've had in the game. I think I so far like it more than Doom. And maybe that's also just a general kind of, like, overall thing. Doom's campaign is, I don't mean to speak ill of it or anything. It's a great, great campaign.
Yes.
Too early for me to judge. I'll have to finish up and see what I think.
It's, the funny thing, though, is one of the things that's weird to me about Titanfall's guns, their guns feel so good. The shooting, I think, is, and maybe Mr. FPS can disagree with me, but I think the guns are really, really fun in that game. The one thing that's odd to me is the snipers, mm-hmm. because it feels so, like, antithetical to what the game is about, to just, like, sit there and snipe. Like, the game doesn't have, unless I'm dumb and haven't found it, doesn't have, like, a prone button. And every time I pick up a sniper rifle, like, I feel like I just want to sit there and go prone and shoot some dudes. Mm. And that's completely the opposite of what the game wants you to do. Because the game, Titanfall 2, lets you do things like reload a shotgun while running on a wall and then shooting someone as you jump off of that wall and then sliding into a giant robot and like shooting some dudes with some rockets. Like, it lets you do things like that, and just standing there and picking people up with headshots feels kind of odd.
It is pretty clever and intentional, and very much like Call of Duty, that it begins you in an obstacle course. I mean, that's the opening sequence of the game. You're almost immediately put in this speed run. You know, how quickly can you get through this from A to B while shooting these targets, while executing different techniques and maneuvers? And it gets you in this, like, safe environment where you can delight in that and try. And, like, I ran through it twice, and yeah, I think that's pretty clever. But I don't know. The sniper rifle is a nice feeling when you're on a wall at high speed and you're threading a needle through a scope at somebody. You have, like, this very narrow window to track them, you know?
Maybe I'm just not good enough to even do that.
Get good, Tom.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I can't. I've tried.
Become good.
So that tutorial, it says you have to finish the course in 2 minutes, which I finished in one my first time, so it was not obviously.
I did in 47, but yeah.
Well, yeah, I wasn't bragging, Evan.
sorry, it's the only source of validation that I have in my life, Chris, shooters, so.
Do you think if someone couldn't finish in 2 minutes, like, no matter how hard they tried, it wouldn't let them? Do you think it really wouldn't let them play the game?
Oh, no, no, no.
Should I find out? Should I botch the tutorial?
There might be a failure state. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, it might hold you back. I'm curious now, because at that point, it's probably like there's something wrong. Like, you don't have a control bound or something, or you're misunderstanding what it is to jump. I don't know.
Maybe you're just new. Like, we also forget that if you haven't grown up with a controller or a keyboard in your hand, like, it can be hard. It's near impossible to navigate a first-person game in 3D space if you are not comfortable with a mouse and keyboard or controller controls.
Sure, yeah, I understand, like, not everyone might make it, but do you think the game would really prevent you from playing it if you couldn't finish that obstacle course? Are they really going to say, you can't play our game until you get through this obstacle course in under 2 minutes? Would they do that?
I would be shocked.
Do we want to put anyone? Should we make a bet on it? Do you think
we'll I bet so. I would put money.
No way.
I would put maybe a dollar on the fact that it would not let you proceed until you complete it.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. I would be surprised. But, okay, tonight I'll try to fail the tutorial as many times as I can.
Do we want to talk at all about, there's some discussion about this, and EA had a recent earnings call, if you guys are paying attention to the cool video game financial news, where, you know, a lot of people are like, gosh, this game is really good. And actually, Chris mentioned it in his review, and like, it's going to get overshadowed by it's sandwiched between Battlefield 1, which we love and is excellent, and is also an EA game, and Call of Duty, which is, again, the, you know, sort of the continuation of Respawn's original work as Infinity Ward. I mean, they left Infinity Ward to become Respawn and make Titanfall. So the timing seems awful on paper. And already, like, EA's stock went down a little bit because some analyst was like, oh, it's only going to sell, like, 5 million copies instead of whatever, 8. I don't know. Is that something we want to talk about? Is that too businessy?
No, yeah. I think real quick, Mother Goose just said PC Gamer Lounge in reference to our betting. So thank you for that great reference. Yeah, no, I think it's something worth talking about because it's one of those things that can easily become a self-fulfilling prophecy of everyone being like, oh, the Titanfall's not, it's great, but no one's playing it and it'll be dead in 2 months. And if you just keep saying that enough, it'll be true. Mm-hmm. But if the conversation isn't about, oh, it's not selling enough copies, and instead the internet conversation is about, holy crap, Titanfall 2 is really good. And not only is it really good, it has absolutely no season pass. All the maps and modes are going to be free that they add to the game. And not only that, it has absolutely no microtransactions. And its single player campaign is great. And all of these things that people have been asking for a long time and complaining about in other shooters are here. We should be playing this. If that's the conversation, then it's not going to die no matter how bad its sales are, like, unless only 10 people buy it. If 5 million people buy the game or whatever, like, it's going to do fine. But if people keep saying, oh, no one's playing it, then, yeah, no one will play it. And that part upsets me because it's probably not going to sell very well. I think it's dumb that it came out a week after Battlefield. I think probably what EA was trying to do, and I realize I've been talking nonstop very quickly, but I think probably what EA was trying to do is They said in their statement, which I'm trying to pull up, that yeah, they basically see it as, like, tactical people will like Battlefield and Twitch people will like Titanfall. So that tells me that really they weren't trying to compete with Battlefield. They were trying to put in a game to fight Call of Duty.
Oh, 100%. And it's very intentional, I think, that they want to come out before Call of Duty. But I do think it's wrong to think that the Battlefield audience and the Titanfall audience are two, like, different pools of people that don't have a lot of intersection. Like, I am one of those people that wants to play both of these games. I love FPSs and I love all flavors of them, but there's only so much resource I have, right? As a player, I think anybody who plays competitive games or, like, games of a certain genre, like 4Xs even, it's like you only have so much love to give, right? And it's a matter of, like, it's especially true in skill-driven games because your investment equals what you're getting out. You know, if I'm playing Rainbow Six, I'm getting better at it in theory. I'm grouping up with my clan and my buddies. I'm having that social experience. I'm giving that to them and getting that out of the experience. I'm growing, right? And, God, I can't grow in, like, 3 or 4 different FPSs at once. I'm very reluctant to play 2 serious competitive games at the same time. I mean, it's the reason, how many people play Dota 2 and League concurrently, right? Mm-hmm. That's a huge, like, you know, black versus white argument or whatever. So, yeah, it's super foolish to hear EA say that. I mean, that it's these, like, two different audiences. I mean, it's absolutely the same audience.
Yeah, here's EA CEO Andrew Wilson's exact quote, just so I can not misquote him in any way. He says, "We think there's really 3 types of players. People that really love Battlefield and that kind of big strategic gameplay that will orient in that direction. The player that loves the fast, fluid, kinetic gameplay of Titanfall 2 that really orient in that direction, and the player that just has to play the 2 greatest shooters this year and will buy both," which is a very, very marketing-y, like, salesy way to put that.
It's such a garbage line. Like, with all respect to EA, I mean, because they have just produced 2 excellent FPSs, you know, 2 of the best of the year with Doom and Overwatch. No, sorry. Like, if you don't think Battlefield has, like, that fast connected aspect to it, depending on the role that you're playing. It can absolutely be a Twitch game if you want it to be, you know, close to the level of Titanfall. So, like,
not to mention they're not thinking of the type of player that has money for one game and needs to make a choice this mm-hmm. holiday season between not just your video games, but all of the options that are out.
There's just so many factors. It's not like one specific thing. I think it's also just peer pressure. You know, if your friend group is like they've always played Call of Duty together or whatever, you know, I think anybody who plays FPSs, they have, like, a culture in that way where, like, they were big TF2 players, they were big TFC players, they were big CS 1.6 players. And that kind of DNA stays in, like, your online gaming group. If you have that group of people, you know, it's very hard to convince that group of people to like, hey guys, like I bought Titanfall. It would be great if like a few of us could jump in there. It's really cool. And they're like, sorry, we're playing Battlefield. Sorry, we're doing the Overwatch Halloween stuff. You know, sorry. We're playing Arma 3. We just discovered this cool mod, you know. There's some inertia there.
Do we think any of this might have something to do with some kind of lingering fallout from the original Titanfall, which I never played to my memory? I heard people say great things about it, and then a few weeks later, I heard no one talking about it because no one was playing it anymore. I mean, it was multiplayer only. There was no campaign. And, you know, losing part of your multiplayer audience kind of leads to losing more of it, because the fewer people are playing, the fewer people are going to want to play or be able to play.
Yeah.
Do you think any of that is remaining? People saying, mm-hmm. Yeah, I bought this last time, and, you know, within 2 weeks, none of my friends are playing, and I'm not going to do it again.
I've definitely seen that in online comments about the game, that just the notion that stigma exists. They're like, well, I wasn't looking for another multiplayer game, or for whatever reason that was undesirable to me in Titanfall 2. But now that I'm hearing that the campaign is really good, maybe I should buy it. Like, I've heard that comment multiple times. I think the other thing that's working against it, though, Chris, is what's grown since the release of Titanfall 1, which was 2013 or 14 earlier. God, I'm sorry.
I'll look it up.
I'm usually so good at game dates. It frustrates me. But I've seen so much of, the campaign's good. I'll just wait until it's $20. I'll just wait until it's super cheap. You know, I don't know. We had this conversation a couple years ago of the notion of like game sales and how frequent they are, like kind of affecting the economics of PC gaming and games in general, as now console games are becoming much more digitally downloadable. But
2014, by the way.
Thanks. I just think that's a behavior that people are embracing now. Like, well, every game will be 50% off in, I don't know, 5 months, at the most. Like, we did a great article on this a couple months ago, actually looking at the averages and how long it takes based on the pricing tiers and stuff. Anyway, like, yeah, if you're a consumer out there and you have a huge backlog, if you're not getting this massive peer pressure from your friend group to like play Battlefield now, play Titanfall now, now is the moment that we're like discovering this together, why wouldn't you save half the value of this game and get the same experience in 6 months or something?
A lot remains to be seen with Titanfall. All I can say is I'm really, really enjoying what I've played of it so far. I'm really excited to jump more into the multiplayer, and especially the capture the flag mode. I've heard it just great things about. And it's just a shame to me that this game is getting such a bad rap for like not anything to do with itself, really. Like, it's getting a bad rap because, like you said, Chris, it's the reputation of Titanfall, and it's getting a bad rap because of what could go wrong with it in terms of player base or like getting it cheaper. And I don't know, it's just disappointing to see that regardless of who's making the game or the publisher or the size of the game, right? Mm-hmm. Anytime that happens to a game, it's just a bummer. So let's move on, though. So let's do some predictions for BlizzCon 2016, because this one's going to be a little bit of, I think, of a lower-key show than last year. Last year, you know, you had Overwatch wasn't quite out yet, and you had Heroes of the Storm was it still in beta, or it was still early on in its life, right? It was a much more tumultuous time. They announced Legion. There was a bunch of stuff going on last BlizzCon. I think this BlizzCon is going to be a little bit lower key, but I want to run through all six of the kind of sprawling tentacles of Blizzard Entertainment and kind of see what you guys think. I'm not comparing them to Hydra. What are you talking about? You're crazy. So let's start, I guess, with one of the easier ones, which is, and one of the ones that maybe you guys won't be able to chime in on as much, which is Hearthstone.
They're going to have some new cards.
Hey, you got it.
I'm an expert.
I mean, Chris, I don't know. That's actually maybe a risky bet. No, that's definitely what's happening. They've been teasing a bunch that this new set is going to be coming out or is going to be announced at BlizzCon. They haven't explicitly said that or anything, of course, but they have teased teasers and all that sort of stuff. They did a little thing about like a bank heist, so people are thinking it's going to kind of be like they've kind of hinted that it's going to be bank robbery, kind of mobster, gangster themed, which is kind of a weird thing to do within the Warcraft world, but that's okay. So let's move on from Hearthstone because that's an easy one. But let's go to its counterpart, WoW. What are you guys expecting from WoW this BlizzCon? I think maybe they announce a new expansion. They said publicly they're not doing anything with legacy servers. That was the other big assumption, was that they would announce, hey, look, we have legacy servers now for WoW, but they've explicitly stated they're not going to do that. Maybe the next update to Legion, like, I'm not really sure what to expect from WoW.
I don't think it'll be that significant, obviously, with how well Legion was received and how recent it was. I mean, what else can there be? I'm trying to remember when they revealed Legion, sort of how long the lead up has been typically between announcement and release for a WoW expansion, but
yeah, it's a little bit, I think WoW will probably have a down year, like a little bit of a low key year this BlizzCon.
I think they're going to go free to play.
Chris, I love these predictions. Keep them coming, please. God, that would change the world.
Well, they are.
The world would just be like shattered.
Can't you play free to level 20 or something like that?
Yeah, you can already do free level 20. It's kind of a similar thing to what Eve is starting this year.
Yeah.
Although a bit different. Another thing, a game that I think is going to have maybe a down year is StarCraft. I'm not sure what they would announced with StarCraft. I feel like they just did their last expansion for StarCraft 2, right? And either they announce StarCraft 3, they announce a new expansion for StarCraft 2, or they just kind of shut up and they let StarCraft have like a rebuilding year.
Yeah, I hate to say it because StarCraft remains one of the best competitive games, you know, regardless of how popular it is over the past several years. But yeah, I do think it's in sort of its waning retirement years as an esport. So I don't know. Hopefully they'll surprise us, but I cannot see StarCraft 3 happening.
No, not at least this BlizzCon.
Warcraft, though, to go back to that. I mean,
do you think they would announce Warcraft?
I mean, just thinking about the arc of StarCraft and the audience that represents in terms of hardcore RTS. I don't know. I don't have a sense of how well the StarCraft 2 expansions have done. It doesn't feel like they've really exploded and gotten a ton of interest and profit. But yeah, I mean, as StarCraft 2 kind of enters its twilight, you've got to imagine that Warcraft is perhaps back on the table in terms of just the personnel within Blizzard making strategy games.
When I talked to the StarCraft 2 development team, I think it was almost a year ago at this point. It was at PAX South, so it was very, very early this year. They kept calling the StarCraft 2 3 sets, right? Heart of the Swarm and Legacy of the Void, and don't remember the Terran one because it's been so long at this point.
Wings of Liberty.
Wings of Liberty, thank you. They called that they called Legacy of the Void the end of the Jim and Kerrigan storyline within the StarCraft mm-hmm. universe, which is Jim Raynor and Kerrigan, basically the two main love interesty characters. They said that this was the end of that arc, but it didn't mean it was the end of StarCraft, and it didn't mean it was the end of StarCraft 2. So I think they wanted to at least leave the door open there. I would be interested to see if they do go back to Warcraft 3. I think a lot of people would be excited by that, but it would be a little bit of a surprise, I think. And I don't think they'll announce it this year, at least.
Yeah, how long has it been?
Since Warcraft 2,
Warcraft 3.
Oh, excuse me, Warcraft 3. I'm sorry. I kept saying Warcraft 3. I meant Warcraft 4. It's been a while since Warcraft 3, though.
Yeah, 2002? Is that right?
Oh, my goodness.
Frozen Throne, I can't remember what year it was. Anyway, I think that would be spectacular. I mean, that would be as big or bigger than me than a Diablo expansion, which we should talk about.
Yes. So Diablo, I think, actually is going to be the big one this year. Diablo was so unimportant last year mm-hmm. at BlizzCon mm-hmm. that they didn't even bring it up on stage.
And throughout this year.
Yeah, basically. They didn't bring it up on the main stage last year at BlizzCon. They didn't even bring it up in the pre-show thing. We forgot about it in our BlizzCon predictions last year because it was just so little was happening with Diablo. And I think this year, even apart from the teasers, because we've gotten a lot of little teases about Diablo stuff, but even aside from that, I think this is just the year that they've been preparing something for. It's important to note Diablo 3 came out 4 years ago. Reaper of Souls came out 2 years ago. And hey, now it's been 2 years since that. So the rumors have been what? We've seen the D4s, the D4 dice that they've sent out.
Well, perhaps more importantly, it is the 10th anniversary.
Yes.
1996.
Of the original
Diablo. I'm sorry, 20. God, I can count. Yeah.
Of the original Diablo, yep. Yeah. And so it's a big year for Diablo, and they sent out these D4 dice that everyone took as D4 Diablo 4, right? Which could be something. But then an interesting piece of follow-up from that is that, if I can load it, this image, there was an image that leaked of this, the Necromancer. The Necromancer characters from Diablo 2, they had this art leaked of a man and a woman version of those characters. And that means something's coming with the Necromancer, but whether it's a Diablo 2 HD remake, whether it's an expansion to Diablo 3 that is adding them as characters, whether it's Diablo 4, we kind of don't know. What's your guys' money on with
that? I think the Necromancer is a beloved character class. I wouldn't be surprised to see that come back and be a focus, even though the Witch Doctor arguably has plenty of overlap in terms of themes and mechanics. I don't know. That art, though, it doesn't look like Blizzard quality art completely. It looks like kind of a very rough concept. Their artists are incredibly talented. So it either doesn't look finished or it looks like it was, meant for just sort of a small placement somewhere, not meant to be used as sort of a desktop wallpaper scale, you know what I mean? So, but yeah, the timing is perfect. Like you said, they've been so quiet. They've got to keep, one or two of their franchises in their back pocket year over year. So, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if Diablo has a big coming out party.
I'm gonna put money on something. I'm going to say that my call for it is now I'm getting nervous, Diablo 3 expansion.
Okay, and where's the expansion set?
That's too much pressure. I don't know about that. Maybe they'll go like Dark Souls 3 did and go snow. And then Forza Horizon is also going snow. Everyone's going snow right now.
If they went snow, they would follow the Diablo 2 expansion, which, God, where did it take you? It had the Barbarian and stuff. Yeah.
I think Diablo 3 expansion, but significant expansion, is probably the direction they go. I can't imagine that. I could imagine they announced Diablo 4, but I think it would be unlikely, basically.
Yeah.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say they're going straight to Diablo 5. They're going to skip 4. They're going to skip 4, announce Diablo 5. People are going to be freaking out. That'll be my guess.
Maybe they'll pull a Battlefield and go Diablo 1. it'll be set in an ancient war in the Diablo universe.
That's too much. I do think it could be a standalone expansion type thing. It could sort of be a somewhere between an expansion and a sequel, you know what I mean? Because
yeah.
Diablo 4, that has such big expectations in terms of bringing all the character classes back and all that stuff, so.
I think when they do go Diablo 4, because I don't doubt that they'll make a Diablo 4 eventually, I think when they do, they'll go back to having a more open world, is my vibe. I think that was one of the main criticisms with Diablo 3 when it first came out, right, was that it was...
There were lots of them, but yes.
Yes. And it's... It's fair to point out that when Diablo 4 or Diablo 3 came out, it was not great, and they fixed a lot of things with the first expansion. And it
took them a while, but
yeah, it definitely did take them a while. But it's cool to see that they've got something else planned for it. But let's go on with the last two. So HOTS, Heroes of the Storm. I think we're gonna get a really boring Heroes of the Storm year. I think it's gonna be, or at least it's gonna be a really exciting Heroes of the Storm year for anybody who plays Heroes of the Storm, and pretty uninteresting to people who don't.
Which Overwatch character will come to Heroes of the Storm?
Oh, man. Winston. I'm going Winston.
I think it's a good pick. He could fit in. I mean, the transformation power feels in line and everything else, the leaping.
The bubble would be cool.
Yeah, I mean, his powers are basically ready to go in that game.
They're going to announce a new game mode that won't come out for a year like they did last year. They're going to announce 3 characters, and they're going to potentially announce a themed set of updates around one of their other games, perhaps, maybe Overwatch levels, or probably more likely Warcraft levels, because Warcraft is their most popular.
Is there no Overwatch map in Heroes of the Storm?
No, not yet. They only have 2 characters.
I think that would be really cool.
I think they'll go Warcraft first. I think I'd put money on... They announced 2 Warcraft maps and three total new heroes. Also, I'll say almost for sure they're going to announce a hero that's super weird. Because 2 years ago, they showed off Lost Vikings. Last year, they showed off Cho'Gall, the double character. And then this year, they're going to show off something strange and an Overwatch character and a different character. It's pretty I think that's a really safe bet. I'd actually go back to PC Gamer Lounge and put money on that.
We've got you on tape, Tom. We can come and score this in a week.
Yeah, you guys can all come back and see how wrong we are. And then the last one we need to talk about is Overwatch.
Yes.
They're going to announce that Sombra was a joke. And that the character doesn't actually exist.
BlizzCon would burn to the ground. How long has this ARG been going on? Like, I don't know. I don't know if you guys have been following the Sombra ARG.
It's been months.
Yeah, we've talked about it on the show a couple times before already.
Like I've really only read it through our site. I haven't dug in and like done research and cared. But man, they have really strung this thing out to BlizzCon.
Yeah. So one of the things that we can pull up here is. There was, again, another image of this character called Sombra was leaked, apparently, officially. This is, so there's this image of her in a different way now than the last time we saw her. This is like, I mean, it looks like the other character. It looks like in what they've been talking about, there's these Omnics down there that she's, like, controlling. It looks in line with something that would be a real leak, right? Like, I just can't imagine.
I mean, the quality of Overwatch fan art is so high
in
some cases that, like, you can never be quite sure. But either way, this stuff does undermine, like, the months of secrecy and, like, you know, bad breadcrumbs they've kind of laid out on this path.
She's getting announced.
Oh,
she's getting released. That's my guess, is they say she'll be on the PTR, the public test realm, on Tuesday, and you can play her here on the show floor.
Yeah.
There it is.
Exactly. Like,
that's absolutely what they're doing. Mm-hmm. The thing that remains to be seen for me is, are they going to announce a second character? Because they said in a developer update YouTube video, there will be another character hot on Sombra's heels, but they also, according to the old leak of Sombra back around the Halloween update coming out, it kind of seemed like they were going to release Sombra with the Halloween update and then change their minds and push her back to BlizzCon. So maybe we're not going to see that other character that was hot on their heels, and maybe we get a hint at that. I don't know. Do you think there's going to be anything on that, or do you think there's anything bigger for Overwatch than just this character?
So I just wrote it down while we were talking a bit ago. August, Summer Games. September, nothing. October, of course, was the Halloween update. November, probably no seasonal thing. But December, they could easily do a Christmassy holiday type event that would follow that pattern.
Yeah, I think that's for sure.
More skins. I mean, I'm playing a ton of games over the holiday break. I don't know about you. Like, that seems like the ripest time of year they could release a bunch of skins, if I'm just thinking in terms of business.
Yeah, they'll probably do Christmas update.
And it's what TF2 does, and they do what TF2 does, so hey.
Oh, shots fired.
Did you play the Halloween update?
Fair enough. Fair point. They'll also probably announce some maps or something. They did that last BlizzCon.
I hope so.
The game remains to be seen.
The game could use one or two more maps for sure before the end of the year. That would be terrific.
Chris, do you have any massive insights on Overwatch?
No, and also the leaf blower guy's coming back, so.
Well, I think that basically is our BlizzCon predictions. Diablo's going to have a really big year. WoW's probably going to have something cool. WoW and Heroes of Storm and Hearthstone are going to have things that are cool for WoW, Hero and the Storm and Hearthstone fans. StarCraft's going to have a down year. Overwatch is going to be Overwatch and be wildly successful and do its thing, and they're going to announce new content for it. Pretty good sum up. We'll see. You can keep an eye on PCGamer.com. All weekend we'll have BlizzCon videos. We're going to be doing interviews. We're going to have a lot of coverage from there. So be sure to keep an eye out on that, and we'll see if we're right or not. And then we'll be back next week on the show to kind of discuss some of the things that were announced and if we were terribly wrong or right or any of that. And if Diablo 5 comes out, like Chris said. But let's move on to our Twitch chat Q&A. And so if you have any questions for us, please tag us with @PCGamer in the Twitch chat, and then we will take your questions. If you're a subscriber on the Twitch channel, then we will try to get to you first as usual. And if you are listening at home at pcgamer.com/podcast or on our iTunes page or at youtube.com/pcgamer or wherever it is, you're always welcome to come join us, twitch.tv/pcgamer, 1 p.m. Pacific time every Wednesday, and we can answer your questions live. While we're waiting for some questions to roll in, I do want to mention also we did have a couple people respond with feedback that they wanted a PC Gamer, official PC Gamer Discord channel. So we have been setting that up. Stay tuned for some more more info about that. Our Twitch subscribers will have a little cool area to hang out in there, and we'll make it a pretty good place. So that's hopefully coming relatively soon. Keep an ear open. All right, we got some questions already rolling in. Subscriber Kunifu asks, do you guys think it's impossible for early access games to retain excitement, hype, or players for their 1.0 release? How can devs avoid their full releases feeling flat and effectively shortening the lifespan of the game? I don't think it would shorten the lifespan of the game. I think that a lot of the most successful early access games prove that they have incredible lifespans.
Kerbal was in early access for 2 years, for example.
Prison Architect as well was, I think, was it 3 years?
Yeah, longer.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there have been some great successes. Clay's games, you know, like...
Don't Starve.
Don't Starve was one. I don't know if Mark of the Ninja was, but Invisible Ink, I believe, was in early access as well. Yeah, I don't know. Short runway definitely helps between early access to final release, but... In terms of, I mean, can you repeat the other part of the question?
How can devs avoid their full releases feeling flat? Is that?
Sure.
Or how do they retain excitement for 1.0? It's both of those things I feel like are kind of not really tasks for 1.0. They're just tasks for the game in general. Mm-hmm. Like the retaining player excitement, if you're doing early access correct for a long time of early access, like... hopefully you're just going up a little bit rather than like a spike or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, the story is not like, because there's always going to be people who just see that label and don't want to dive in, but look at Ark. Ark is tremendously successful, and yes, they did like one of the worst things within early access this year, which is releasing a paid expansion while they were still in early access, which is just really irresponsible. But nevertheless, they've been able to just maintain a steady massive group of people around that game because a lot of people enjoy it, and that's what needs to be done. I mean, just make an excellent game that has a thriving community around it like anybody else, and then I think once you know you move to 1.0, so to speak, a certain type of person is going to say, oh, it's ready for me, you know, it's done, great, I'll jump in, that's a green light for me. Or it's just sort of an extra signal that they can send out and say like, hey, we're happy. I guess the other approach would be like to withhold some like big anticipated feature like co-op or whatever, but
right.
You know.
Let's
see. I do kind of see that sometimes where a game will leave early access and our reaction is like, oh, that's out of early access. Like it, we were aware of the game, we weren't really aware of the official launch. I think, you know, probably a lot of it is you know, prepare a new trailer, prepare new screenshots, try to get some word out there that you're launching for real.
Let's see. BattleTank09 asked this last week, so I do want to hit it. Do you guys read any web comics? Kind of a simple question to answer real quick. I read Penny Arcade a lot. I love that comic. I read that basically every time they update it. But we have a famed web comic creator on the show today in Chris Livingston.
Oh yeah.
You have like fans for that, man. You got longtime fans.
I do still, yeah, I still get email about it, and I still...
Come on, Chris, plug your thing. It's great.
Yeah, well, it was 11 years ago now. I did a fan comic for Half-Life 2. It was called Concerned, the Half-Life and Death of Gordon Froman. I used Gary's mod to put it together, and it was based on an NPC in Half-Life 2 who sort of... He went through the game on the same path as Gordon Freeman eventually would, but he was an idiot. And I think there are 150 episodes of it. I don't know.
What Chris is trying to say is hlcomic.com, guys.
I don't have that anymore.
What? Really?
I don't have that. You have to go to screencuisine.net. It's somewhere on there. I don't have hlcomic.com anymore. I'm almost certain. It
seems to load.
Seems we're on the page right now.
I don't think that's my website.
Okay. Well, it's your comics.
So. I'll double check. I moved it all to Screen Cuisine because I lost the... yeah, that's not mine, I don't think.
Oh, wow. Did somebody rip you off? It says by Christopher Livingston.
Probably.
What?
Yeah. I didn't... Oh, yeah, that's not...
Holy
that's
smokes.
Not somebody, no way.
Somebody plagiarized you? Oh, my yeah. God, Chris. It even has your copyright on it, dude.
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna get the bomb. We're gonna get the bomb. This anyway.
Don't go there. I don't know what the site is.
I thought this was like a question about webcomics. Don't go there. I'm gonna delete that right now.
Screencuisine.net is Chris's.
Yes.
I can't believe that. I'm timing myself out. That's crazy, dude.
Like, it's not the first time I've seen my shit, my comics, my blog. I've seen it appear all over the place. People just steal it. One guy made a book out of it. One guy, he printed out and made a really nice looking book, though. That was awesome.
What?
It was like a real comic book. He did an amazing job.
Oh, okay. But he didn't really sell it or something.
No. He just wanted, okay. He just liked the comic and wanted to make it into a comic book. And that's really cool.
That's cool.
Wow.
That stuff is great.
Well, we can use this moment in court later. but let's take a couple more questions before we end. Here's a question that's actually a pretty easy one to answer also. AlexGold95 asks, will Skyrim Special Edition get its sound quality fixed? Have the high quality sounds been back from the original game?
We hear that they are working, that Bethesda's going to fix it or is working on a fix. I don't think it's been fixed yet, but from what I understand, they're going to undo whatever compression they put on the audio files and we'll fix it. And if not, there's already a way to take the sound files from the original game and put it into the new game, and I'm sure it'll be fixed one way or the other.
Yeah, and also there's a mod, right? Like, there's already somebody did it?
There are instructions how to... there's probably a mod. Honestly, there probably is. There were someone posted instructions about how to extract the sound files and drop them into the new game.
Well, let's. There's a couple more. Let's see. Question: do you guys have any news regarding United Front Games shutting down? This is actually something I don't think we've talked about on the show yet. That United Front Games, the creators of Sleeping Dogs, and they were making a game called Smash and Grab, kind of very unexpectedly just shuttered their doors and took Smash and Grab off of Steam and shut down. And honestly, I don't think we know anything new about that. It's a bummer. It's a huge bummer to see that happen. To pretty much any studio, and yeah, it's sad.
I think it's just in the financial background of the game. It's something that we can't or may never know.
Yeah.
I mean, they were actually saying like, hey, do you want to run this like promotion for Smash and Grab? Like, do you want to give away some keys or something? Like right before they closed, they were emailing us with stuff like that. So yeah, I have reason to believe through that like their employees were totally surprised by it. I don't know.
They were doing Triad Wars, right? It was that mm-hmm. It was like a Sleeping Dogs MMO type thing, which I think I played last year, and I assume that's shut down as well.
I know Smash and Grab has been removed from Steam, and I think refunds were issued. So,
all right, let's take one last question before we wrap up here, which is. Varendale asks, what does Gwent need to do to reach the level of popularity Hearthstone has achieved? Is it even possible or likely? I don't think that's possible, and I don't think it's likely. I think it will be very popular. Wes has been very much enjoying it in his time in the closed beta so far. But I think the more important thing is, I don't think it needs to, man. I don't think any card game needs to try and be the next Hearthstone. Hearthstone is this crazy, insane thing. That would like be saying in physical card games, if you were like, do you think this new card game that's coming out is going to topple Magic the Gathering? It's like, no, but it doesn't need to, and that's not anything that it should aspire to do. It should just be try to be a good game.
Well, it's already doing a good thing by being very mechanically distinct from Hearthstone and Elder Scrolls Legends, which is much closer to Hearthstone, even though it has some key differences. But again, how are they going to make the game appeal to non-Witcher players? I think that's a huge and challenging question for them, because the format is not like Magic and not like something that's very popular and instilled in like a whole genre. I don't know. That's a huge question. Obviously, Witcher 3 is really popular. Maybe that'll give them enough players, but I don't know. If I was making that game, I'd be worried about that. You should play Elder Scrolls Legends, though, because it's really good.
Are you still playing that a lot?
I'm not, but I'm looking forward to getting back into it once they release some new stuff. But it's an excellent card game. So I think there's room within genre for more, even as we've seen so many crop up over the past, like, 2 or 3 months.
Yeah. And Gwent's looking good so far. I mean, I was talking to you about this actually earlier this week, Evan, that, like, with Titanfall also, like, I don't like this idea that if a game doesn't have millions and millions of players for 2 years, then it's like a dead game. Games can just kind of be chilling on their own, especially when there's so many good card games coming out. It's like they can all have their own little corner of the market and be doing their thing and making money and making a good game, and, like, that's fine.
Yeah, it's interesting the way that the transparency around Steam concurrent player stats, and particularly around SteamSpy.com, which samples data, you know, if you haven't been to that website, it estimates how many people own a game or are playing a game based on, like, it samples public Steam profiles and says, like, okay, Tom owns these 300 games and I own these 300 games or whatever, and extrapolates that stuff with some margin of error. But yeah, like, with that stuff being visible, even if it isn't perfectly accurate, it's amazing how much it's become part of the discussion for what I see as average PC gamers to talk about, like, oh, God, you know, DayZ only sold 4 million copies and blah, blah, blah. And you're like, who cares about that stuff? I don't know. I'm interested in it as a journalist and as someone who has to cover this stuff. But I don't know. The financial success of games as, like, a subject of normal discussion among players is, like, I don't know. That's, like, the most boring shit I can think of.
Well, I think that's all the time we have for questions today, but be sure to join us again next week, Wednesday, 1 p.m. Pacific time, right here at twitch.tv/PCGamer or on youtube.com/PCGamer, or if you want to leave us a comment, go to PCGamer.com/podcast, click on today's post, and let us know what you're thinking about life, the universe, and everything.
Yeah, we'll have that BlizzCon debriefing next week.
Yes, we will. It'll be fun, I think, to be completely wrong about everything. Chris is gonna be right in all his predictions, and I'm just gonna have made a fool of myself.
They'll just do the number thing where they'll put the number zero in Diablo. It'll be Diablo, and it'll be like a prequel to the whole series, right?
It's like this, the creation of the Earth. It's like a space game instead.
Yeah.
I guess it's Sanctuary is the name of that world.
Very good.
I play too many Blizzard games. Oh, my God. But thank you, everyone, for joining us. And we'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.